Again, happy Easter, everybody. Grace, mercy, and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. So there's an Easter catchphrase that we rejoice in this season. I'm going to ask you to say it with me now because we will use it later. So I will say Christ is risen, and your response is, He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Let's try it. Christ is risen. Awesome. I'm asking for your participation from the beginning here because that's really part of what Easter is all about. Not a one of us would be able to completely celebrate the miracle of Easter on our own. And you know what? Easter's fun. So we're going to play a quick round of what I will call Resurrection Jeopardy. A much more simplified version than the TV game show. I'm going to split you in teams, okay? So this entire section here, you are team one. This center section here, all the way back, you are team two. And over here, including our musicians, team three, okay? So I'll make a statement, and you complete it by using what is or who is questions. You know how to play. So are we ready or not? Here we go. Team number one, the living organism from which the Easter Bunny gets eggs. Love it. What are chickens? What? Eggplants. Duh. All right, team number two, let's try it. The Easter Bunny stays fit with this form of physical activity. What is? Exercise. Come on, egg, get it? I mean, are we all on board now? Okay, let's see if team three can help us out. This is what happens to Easter eggs when they hear silly jokes. What is? They crack up. Okay, team three is the only one who got it. Great job. Unfortunately, there are no prizes or daily doubles, except that you get to sit through the rest of the sermon. That's a gift in itself, am I right? Speaking of Easter eggs, did you know that they're also called paschal eggs? Paschal. It's from the Greek pascha, or the Hebrew pesach, which refers to the Jewish Passover. Also, if you've studied Spanish in school or otherwise, you may have learned that the term for Easter is La Pascua. The point being that for centuries, people all over the world have decorated eggs to celebrate this time of year. Eggs are a symbol of fertility, rebirth, and new life. And isn't it interesting that the season we leave behind in Easter, called Lent, actually means spring? So it's like this, that Lent is a time of preparation and developing faithfulness, which leads us into a new way of life with God. And you know, a resurrected life is certainly a new way of living. Traditionally, now you weren't altogether wrong over here with your answer about chicken eggs, because they were used for decorating. But since they're so delicate to paint and not exactly accident-proof, today we might use what? Hard-boiled, plastic, or even chocolate and jelly bean eggs to celebrate the season. Easter eggs symbolize the empty tomb of Jesus. The place where new life has sprung up. An egg is a seed planted, the origin of many generations. It is, in fact, the first home of many offspring for birds and turtles. And for us, the egg is one of those ordinary, everyday reminders of how our lives are extraordinarily made new because Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. So we have four Gospels in our Bible canon that tell us about the resurrection of our Lord. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John give similar, but still different accounts of the first Easter day. There are variations about the number of women who were there, the purpose of their visit, the nature and appearance of the angelic messengers, whether human or otherwise. So, you know, I'm reminded of what it would be like if four of us gathered here today were to tell our very own version of the NCAA Final Four basketball games that happened last night, which is a huge deal and somewhat of a touchy subject in my household right now. If we were to recall the events, to remember, to retell and then write down the details, well, we'd certainly have varying interpretations of what happened, especially whether your team wins or loses, right? Now, if you're someone who cares about the facts, what we do know for sure is that the important details are constant. Jesus' body was lifeless on the cross. He was prepared for burial and put to rest in a tomb that was borrowed and hewn into a rock, behind a boulder that no single person could move alone. We know that the account of an empty tomb took place on the first day of the week, early in the morning, and that the women who were closest to Jesus were the first ones to see it. Those are the facts. But the rest? The rest is up to faith. Because the tomb was empty. There is something about emptiness, is there not? Something that makes us feel unsettled, maybe amazed or even unsure. Empty is certainly not a term that I would choose to describe the way we celebrate Easter. In fact, for as long as I can remember, Easter has been full of joyful memories with family and friends. Growing up, my family belonged to a Lutheran church in historic Williamsburg, Virginia, where I was baptized and confirmed. And I have so many memories of those Easter mornings. Beautiful Easter dresses, hand-sewn by my grandmother, white straw hats with ribbons and gloves, the sweetness of chocolate bunnies and black licorice jelly beans, which are my absolute favorite. And of course, our Easter egg hunts on the campus lawn at the College of William and Mary. Here, you see photos of our Easter egg hunt yesterday here at Zion. Some wonderful memories made together. For me, these are memorable times filled with love and joy and laughter. Times when we gather together, we worship together, we share a meal together, and we receive salvation as a gift from God together. And whether or not you have those memories from years gone by, you are here today to make new ones, to cherish and remember the gift of this day from now on into the future. And it's a little bit ironic, don't you think, that we celebrate an empty tomb, but in order to be filled to the brim and overflowing with new life and renewed energy, then we must empty ourselves, putting to rest those life-wrenching people and practices that serve only to limit our joy, so that when we die each day to sin, we may rise in the morning with Christ. And the good news is that it just keeps getting better, because the gospel is not finished here. Did you know that we celebrate the gift of the resurrection every time we gather as a family of faith? Every Sabbath or day of rest, we call a little Pascua or a little Easter. Have you ever wondered why Sundays don't count in those 40 days of Lent? Because we are resurrection people. We were made for this day. And together we recognize and remember that we live because Christ lives. We are free from the limitations of sin and those things we die to each day because Christ is victorious, Lord of all. We rise up from our struggles to new life because he goes ahead of us and he has been raised. So in this celebration of being together, we find our home in the glory, laud, and honor of an empty tomb. As a kid, we used this older green hymnal in worship. Maybe some of you are familiar with this Lutheran Book of Worship. I remember many Sundays when I assisted in worship with the singing of the liturgy. In the service of the word, there's a song called the Te Deum. It means you are God. And the introduction tells the Easter story every week, directly from Scripture. And it really speaks for itself. On the first day of the week, at early dawn, the women went to the tomb, taking spices which they had prepared. But when they went in, they did not find a body. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, Why do you seek the living among the dead? Remember what he told you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise. You know, sometimes Scripture speaks louder to me through song. And maybe you can relate. Did you hear that part? Remember what he told you while he was still in Galilee. This is crucial to the message of Mark's gospel on this Easter day. The city of Galilee is the key to why we can and why we do celebrate the miracle of Easter as the foundation of our faith still to this day. Why Galilee? Well, because it's home. Galilee is the place where so many of Jesus' disciples call home. It's a place where people who see and experience his divine power believe in the Messiah, who is the Son of God, the Savior of the people. So as much as Easter is about new life, it's also about returning home to the place, the people, and the God from whom you first came, remembering all that you have seen and heard and experienced in the meantime. Jesus Christ is risen today and tomorrow and every day after that. And you know, it may seem easier to see or feel the risen Christ among us in a packed Easter worship service or in a beautiful morning sunrise. But where then? Where then is Jesus when we return to our homes? He goes ahead of us. When people gather for Easter dinner, he is there. When the dishes pile up, the house needs cleaning, the cars need washed, and the kids need feeding, he is there. When the daily tasks of life add up and your to-do list grows faster than you could even imagine checking it off, Christ is there. And if home is where the heart is And if our hearts are focused on faith, well, then Jesus lives each day in you and in me. And he has gone ahead of us so that we can remember in all things, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Amen.